can never get behind the underlying technical assumption of how they're going to scale the technology to be cost effective. And you're seeing it today. You're seeing beyond, like plant-based, struggling, right? The IPO of 2018-19, something like that, it was boom, amazing. And now it is struggling because of the profitability factor.
Yo, this is Christian D. Evans with Journey with Christian D. Evans podcast. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in and listening to our amazing podcast. This is where we reveal the top 1% of business concepts and systems and processes to scale 8- and 9-figure businesses. We interview top-level 8- and 9-figure CEOs, business owners, and amazing TEDx speakers like David Meltzer. We got Nick Cavuto, Pascal Bachman, and so many others. And if you feel like this resonates with you, please share this with your friend, your family, and make sure you impact them as well. Because we're trying to spread the message on those that do not know how to scale 8- and 9-figure businesses and talking higher level business concepts. So guys, remember, enjoy the episode and be uncommon if you can. Cheers. Thank you so much for tuning into Journey with Christian D. Evans podcast. I'm your host, as always, Christian D. Evans. And guys, this next guest is known for saying he likes to back problems worth fighting for. His venture capital firm focuses on investing in early stage companies, solving humanity's most critical crises. And that's the reason why I wanted to have him on. Man, I'm so excited about unpacking his journey, his foundation, as well as everything that he's got going on with his amazing venture capital firm. This man was previously a chief strategy officer at Sharp Electronics, where he headed the digital transformation and technology sourcing effort. He also ran new product development initiatives and supply chain at Jonhson and Johnson. We've all very familiar with that company. He also holds an MBA from University of California, Berkeley, has School of Business. He also has an MS in Industrial and Operations Engineering and a BS in Electronic Engineering from University of Michigan. So to say he is smart is downplaying it. My friends, please welcome the general partner of Creative Ventures, my friend, Champ Suthipongchai. How are you doing today, Champ?
Very good, Kristen. Thanks to you for a wonderful intro.
Well, man, I really appreciate diving into this, and I love your guys' strategy because, one, it's really focusing, like I mentioned here, investing in early-stage companies solving humanity's most critical issues, critical crises. And I love that strategy because that really, embodies just who you are as a person, Champ. And I want to ask, what was the evolution of that? At what point going from corporate to then getting into the venture capital world where you're able to say, hey, you know what? This is my driving force. This is where I want to go. Tell me that journey, man.
Yeah, at the time, I was pretty exhausted with the politics of doing transformation. If you've done like corporate innovation, you know that a lot of the times you spend more time pushing agendas, convincing, lobbying than actual meaningful work, right? Which is not to say that lobbying is the meaningful work, it is, but it's probably not what I signed up to do. So at the time, I was pretty young. Decided to go back to get my MBA at Berkeley. Started dabbling into innovation consulting. It was just so fun to kind of just, instead of being on a corporate side, being on a consulting side, working, big corporates on a leading edge of innovation. And then at some point, I just started to realize too that even that is probably a bit too slow for me. It's probably not cutting edge enough. And that's when I started moving toward more of a startup side, working for 99 Design, which is a corporate, which is a design marketplace. And then along the way, started doing angel investing, looking at opportunities. And that was pretty opportunistic in terms of how that came about. I didn't really think about me becoming a VC and I never thought I would be on the investment side. But as I dabble more into it, hey, this is pretty fun. But then I realized, I'm probably not the kind of guy who's just gonna be investing generally and just looking at every opportunity that's out there. So I started thinking about, should I form a thesis? If so, kind of what areas? And, started pulling in some of my friends who are now my business partner, James and Alex. Eventually we started the venture fund, Creative Ventures, which is an early stage deep tech venture fund together. And that's kind of why we got to where we are today.
Well, you have a really incredible portfolio. You were sharing offline about $65 million AUM. And, just to share with you a few for our audience, like Simo, Caper, Alice, Veracool, Riven, so many more, of course, going down into that portfolio and a lot of industries as well. And I'd like to just start with this a little bit, okay? What kind of really categorizes this kind of portfolio that allows to establish or conquer that crisis, like to be able to solve that big problem that humanity is facing. Well, how does Champ, right? Help me understand how Champ thinks in regards to looking at a deal.
Yeah, I'll backtrack a little bit and talk about sort of like how he, you know, sort of like the overarching picture, right? In terms of like where we invest and why we do it. So when I first started in 2015, early 16, at the time Uber sort of like reigning at the top of the world, the app economy was probably at its peak. And you know, a lot of the VCs, so was already moving into B2B SaaS. So we had two choices, right? We go with the mainstream and go into the B2B SaaS. And we just sort of saw this the demarcation that's obviously not very clear in hindsight. Whereas bigger funds is getting bigger, and you know they become sort of more generalist funds investing in software. And you know there's a niche fund that kind of specializing, because in the days every VC fund was probably more of a generalist than a specialist. The generalists get bigger, and the smaller guys just becomes more specialized. And we asked ourselves, you know, where do we see the opportunity? You know, do we see it in sort of like B2B SaaS? And obviously, there's a ton of those. But you know, do we actually care about it? And to be honest, I couldn't get myself to care about the problem very much. And it didn't seem like, yeah, it seems like I'm going to be one of the many players in that field. So you know, we kind of switched gears and asked ourselves, hey, what are some of the biggest problems? And the biggest problems isn't, we don't want just a big problem today. We want a problem that's painful, that becomes more painful every day. And you know, part of it is I came from corporate technology purchasing background, right? So when you do digital transformation, you look at a lot of technology options. One of the things that I realized is that it's not the big problem that matters, it's the growing problem that matters. It's the one that, where if it's painful, but it's there, you kind of forgot about it, becomes numb, and basically it's just business as usual. It may be bad, it may be broken, but you don't know it's broken because the magnitude isn't increasing. So we are looking for problems that are secularly growing every day. And we look around, we look at many trends. Some of them are more fads, secular, and no matter what we look at, we sort of arrive, you know, at these three trends. The labor shortages, which obviously today is super pronounced, but 7 years ago, it was not. And people were like, labor what? At the time when I started, climate change, again, we were like 15 folks just coming out of clean tech 1.0, you know, where a lot of the fund were investing in clean tech. Kleiner was a big one. That billion-dollar green tech fund didn't do well. So we you know, again, it wasn't as clear as climate tech is today when we first started. And in healthcare, was obviously always there. But in healthcare, what I have to look at is the rising cost of care. It wasn't just about digitization of healthcare or digitization of everything just having to be applied to healthcare. It was the fact that the healthcare cost has been rising steadily, you know, from 10% of GDP. The US is now 20% of GDP. And in fact, the US healthcare market alone is 50% of the global healthcare market. And it's just keep getting worse and worse and worse. And you know, over time, we're probably gonna get into like 20, 25, 30% GDP, you know, healthcare costs as a percentage of GDP. So we look at these three things. We see that these trends are making the problem so acute that there would just be no other choice but to adopt, you know, these technologies. And the kind of technologies that can solve these problems just happen to be things that are not on the phone, right? These are deep technologies. So inadvertently, we become deep tech companies. All the companies that you mentioned, whether it's Blex, Riven, Echo, which is an advanced ultrasound company, Picnic, which is a pizza automation company, Terra, a low carbon concrete. You know, these are companies that, you know, where the solutions exist to solve these crises born out of these secular trends that we have absolutely no way to solve. We just have to kind of learn to cope with it. So the inception of the fund really was looking at these big problems that are growing every day and the advanced technologies that are necessities that become that necessitate solving these problems.
So you're really looking at the trends at a macro level. And then you're also looking at these industries that are basically archaic that are ripe for innovation. And you're able to say, okay, hey, this is the technology. You know, I love what you said there. It's not this pain where it's like, oh, I need an aspirin. It's this whole like, okay, this whole arm is like severed and I need some sort of help. Like there's massive, massive difficulty and pain. And that's how you look at it when you're looking at a deal. And obviously you want to make sure that it's deep tech. So then that's, you know, ripe for innovation. And Champ, let me help me understand a little bit further as well, because even within the deep tech, you guys, you know, your portfolio, you know, healthcare, you got automotive, you got construction, energy, logistics, manufacturing, right? These big trends, right? And I love that you're kind of hitting these large industries that are already pretty well established, but they're ready for, they're very archaic, right? And right. So when you're looking at this, because I've heard where a lot of people, they put a lot of emphasis on the founder when they're looking at that company at that startup stage, whatever it is. As creative ventures, how much emphasis do you guys put on the founder versus the proof of concept as well as the macro trend? What does that look like?
Yeah, that's a great question. And, you know, it's sort of like back to your previous question in terms of how to look at deals, right? So obviously, you know, if you think about like the three triangles of deal, there's the market, there's the founder, there's the technology product, right? And you need all three to be great in order to have a great successful billion-dollar company. So the question is, what's the lead? Obviously, every fund will look at all of them, right? No fund will say they don't care about founders, or will say they don't care about technology or the market. But every fund will lean towards something. And I'd say that something is really, it's really based on the kind of companies that you fund. So when we first started, hey, let's pick, you know, we sort of see this limitation of the market. We choose to deal with the big problems that are growing every day. Then D-Tech has just happened to be the solutions that are solving these problems. So there's a special characteristic about D-Tech that is unlike the previous generation of all startups, which are predominantly software. Is the inability to pivot. So, you know, typically, you know, if you think about like the typical love stories, how founders come to be, you know, college dropouts in a garage, working on apps over months, launch it, you keep iterating on it, you get running profitability, iterating for it forever until you find product market fit, you know, raise Series A, Series B money, grow it, you know, so boom, IPO, right? They can iterate on the product kind of indefinitely for a very long time. And just to kind of, you know, find product market fit. We've seen, you know, seen companies that started as B2C company, that end up being API companies, nothing to do with each other, all right? And that doesn't really work in deep tech. Just the way deep tech companies incepted is that they're based usually on 10, 15 years of researches coming out of university labs. So for us, you know, it's very important. We build a very strong relationship to a bunch of, you know, great universities, Berkeley, Stanford, Northwestern, MIT, and so on and so forth, because these, you know, the PhDs are the founders. They then get funded by university grants and subsequently government grants to fund things that are not possible by VC to funds. And they do that for 10, 15 years. Once they do that, then, you know, at some point the founders start contemplating, hey, maybe I should become a founder. The PhDs contemplate that I should become a founder, and they do. But the problem is that these 10, 15 years of researches, you can't really tweak it that much. So to commercialize it, there really has to be a market for that. And our VC fund really specializing in understanding the market opportunity first to see if this deep tech product or deep technologies can actually be commercialized. Because if there's no market for it, you know, it takes about 9 to 12 months to actually know if there's even a product market fit, because virtually all deep tech companies, most 90% of them are probably like B2B, and there's some other 10-15% of them that are military base. So either way you go, it's going to take 9-12 months for the sales cycle to know whether or not there's some level of market. And so for us, this is an impediment that we understand the market opportunity and whether these problems exist before we even take a look at the company itself. So in sort of the order of the picking order of how we think about it, usually a VC will say, hey, you know, is this a great founder? And then they will say, all right, is this a great founder based on, you know, whatever they're based on. A lot of it, a pattern recognition that I don't know if it's a photo BS, but so it is. Some people can do it, not everyone can. And then they'll look at marketing product and they'll do it into some deals. For us, it's really market first. you know, is there a market for this kind of technology? Is there an alignment of incentive, for example, in healthcare? Is the market too fragmented in certain areas for app? It could be like, is there a seasonality is going to kill the technology or not, or commercialization of it? So once we understand that, then we go into the technology, and where we don't invest in, we don't invest in science projects. That's really government grants. What we like to invest in is stuff that already proven in the lab scale. And what we would take is the engineering risk. So the risk of scaling, manufacturing, putting steel on the ground if need be, or just, you know, basically getting from one robot to like a fleet of robots. So that's the kind of things we would do and take that kind of engineering scalability risk, as opposed to does this thing work on the lab. And we found that typically founders who are thoughtful about the market, who understand deeply about who the customers are, you know, what reimbursement codes would you use, who exactly are you going to sell to an organization, how do you get to them, what are the budget approval limits. People who understand that and understand that the technology is feasible enough to sell to these people, they usually make a pretty good founder because of that in-depth understanding. So it's not, you know, these tech founders are not 20 something years old, right? You know, dropped out of MIT and building apps. That's not what it looks like at all. These are more like, you know, 30s, 40s. We have, you know, our best founders actually in the 60s. One of them actually just passed away, knock, knock. But yeah, you know, they tend to be on the older side. They tend to be very seasoned, either entrepreneur or professionals that decided to become entrepreneur. And that's sort of the pecking order of how they look at deals.
Okay, that makes sense, because I was talking to someone in regards to kind of like the market, you know, penetration possibility, right? And what that looks like. So if you're talking, you know, manufacturing, and there's a $100 billion kind of market cap in that area, do you guys anticipate, like, hey, you know, with this startup, right, after kind of anticipating you got proof of concept established, you obviously got the founder, check, and then saying, hey, you know what is there, like, in a, you know, kind of a goal, and saying, hey, we want to scale this and get like 1% of that market. And with that 1%, you guys can kind of reverse engineer and say, hey, with that, we understand that the top line is going to be this and the bottom line is going to be this. And we can anticipate that growth and that trajectory, because everybody wants 90%, but we can't, you know, guarantee. And I do know the VC world, you guys want to get that more of that unicorn strategy. And then obviously you have a third that will obviously be, you know, hit that mid tier. So I'm just curious how, you know, what that looks like in regards to that market at a macro level, and then kind of reverse engineering and say, okay, hey, you know what, we see the founder, they have the proof of concept established. Wonderful, we can invest, we want to write a check, wonderful. And then what does that look like in regards to trajectory and stuff like that?
Yeah, no, that's a great question, because our public construction actually flying to the face of conventional VC, which relies a lot on it, you know, on the exponential growth and basically finding, you know, one or two companies that basically return the fund, right? So the power law, so to speak. You know, we don't think of it as much that way. What we aim for, right, is because most of the companies really die because of the market risk. They just fail to find product market fit. But if you can reverse engineer that, then ideally you should be able to find a lot more companies that A, can have more product market fit, and B, be able to exit faster, right? Because they don't really need to. I'll separate between these two points. But the way we look at this, because if you can solve for product market fit before you even find a company, you reduce biases. You're not investing into 6 feet bonehead, blue eyes, guy from Stanford, right? Which is pretty much the profile of all the VCs. And that's a bias inherent in anyone, including us. But if you actually can solve, you know, for the right market to invest in, then you rid of some of that, and your investment universe is more, and you play with less biases, which means ideally you're more likely to also make, you know, better decisions and more correct decisions. But it also means that your hit rate is going to be higher. So you don't actually always have to hit, you know, don't always have to shoot for this, like, this moon, right? Or like the five moons beyond. You don't always have to aim for 1,000x. Your investment universe is expanded because you're able to have a higher hit rate. So for us, you know, it's just our fund too, right? We've been around for like about almost 5 years, you know, 90% of our companies, you know, are still in the markets. About like 78% of them have already raised Series A. And, you know, a handful more has raised Series B and C. So we have a track record of having a really high hit rate because we get rid of ourselves of the biases by focusing first on the problems, then the technology, and then the founder will come in once we have the knowledge to actually have intelligent conversation with the founder, whether or not this makes sense. And consequently, because of that, you know, the way we think about portfolio is a third will probably die still. There's a lot of idiosyncratic risks. You can't control for everything. COVID hits, recession hits, et cetera, things happen. A third of them would do really well, like, you know, 15, 20X and more on that realm. And then a third of it, we expect, you know, probably like, you know, 1 to 5X. It wouldn't be wonderful, but it wouldn't go to zero, right? So far our track record is sort of tracking in that way, a third. Subsequently, you don't really have to rely on just going to the moon. And the moon means IPO. And IPOs in the day where there's so much money in the world means it's taking longer time to exit. And because we don't have to rely on that mechanics, our exit strategy could be by acquisition at a very meaningful price. We go in a seed. So, you know, getting exit at a B or C after the race of B, ideally, that is already 50, 20X for us. And so the way we construct portfolios just mean, you know, more consistency, higher hit rates, and just faster liquidity.
So this is a really good point. I'm glad you brought this up, kind of the structure of this. And I appreciate you kind of just unpacking that for our audience. Let's dive deeper into this because when you guys come in, it's not just a matter of writing a check. You guys come in with your experience as well, your expertise. And what does that look like in regard to like structure of the deal, right? I know it's very contextual depending upon the deal, whether it's equity, whether that's debt, whether that's maybe tiered out and saying, hey, that's earned or performance equity for, you know, kind of people adjusting that, as it grows. And then also, do you guys also help raise that capital? What's that kind of extra little bit of energy that you guys bring when you guys bring, you know, that extra value instead of just not just writing a check, but also, you know, your expertise, your energy to help these companies, you know, get over these hurdles of raising capital or just proof of concept, or as well as just building the right team in the ecosystem?
Yeah, I'd say like you see one company, right? I mean, obviously there's pattern, but every company will have their own unique challenges, people dynamics, products, markets, hiring, recruiting, board governance, you know, fundraising. I say like a common trait for all of our companies, not all of them, but a lot of them, because by virtue of being deep tech, is that these are highly technical founders who just can't tell a story to save their life. I mean, you know, you wish they're good at everything, but most people are not good at everything. And that's why a lot of time, we spend a lot of time just helping the founders, helping them understand that what they want to tell isn't what the audience want to hear, right? I'd say like comparatively, you know, B2B SaaS founders are more business savvy. One would say they have to be by nature. They tell better story than highly technical PhD founders. So that's just sort of the flip side of the equation, right? On the flip side, you know, the technology, the business tends to have, you know, more IP, more technological robustness and defensibility and all of that. So it's the game, you know, it's the string of weaknesses, the kind of companies that they play. We spend a lot of time. As soon as, you know, the investment is done, usually you take a board seat, a board server seat. We take a look around at the company. And we basically have a frank conversation. We share our investment memo with them and say, hey, you know, this is what we wrote about you. These are the risks we see. Do you agree with it? Why not? Let's have a very frank discussion about it. And usually one of the things will always be, yep, the founder needs to work on his storytelling ability and getting rid of all the technical jargon, which, you know, all of us basically have advanced degrees of PhDs on our team. Anyway, so we can wade through all the technical jargon. We don't care about all of them, we care about some of them, but most VCs, which is, and especially as they get more finance, you know, more finance heavy VC, they're just not gonna care about these technical jargon, right? So it's about getting rid of those, replacing with a VC to understand story about what the market actually cares about, and preparing them for Series A and thinking about, all right, what do you need to hit to Series A? You know, what are you going to hit in the next 6 quarters on the way to Series A? And basically charting out the map and keeping accountable through the one-on-one meetings and also through the board meetings. And usually, you know, it takes about like 3 to 6 months really to like for founders to really get comfortable. Relationship isn't built in one day. Sometimes it's built during the fundraising process, which sometimes takes longer than the normal. Sometimes we know them longer, but 3 to 6 months, I'd say, you know, that's when founders get really comfortable with us and really start sharing, you know, what the hopes and dreams and fears and all of these problems are. And we get into the weeds. And, you know, especially as we get fundraising, obviously, you know, investor intros and all that, we do all of that. But it's really the prep work before you actually even get to the next investor that actually is important. Because if they're great, there is absolutely no reason why they shouldn't be able to raise the fund, right? So the question for us is, how do we get them to be great? What story do we want to tell and to build toward the story? We want to help them do everything necessary toward that Series A story. That, you know, obviously it's the last one in Series A, but that's how we think about it. It's from, just make it simple, from C to A, what's the story, and execute towards that.
See, I love how you're just making it so simple, right? You know exactly what needs to take to get over those hurdles. And I think that's why it's an interesting conversation. So you really focus on that Series A, getting that proof of concept, but also really making sure that that story, that founder story, is so relevant. And like you mentioned, very few founders, because they may get, you know, talk more technical, you know, I like to call it techno babble, you know, it's more like technical aspect, when the reality is they need to be kind of really solidifying that, the goal, the dream, the vision, whatever that is, and unpacking that. And I like what you mentioned. And also, you do take a board seat because that is able to help you kind of navigate that company to that next level and being able to have a really strong say. I've heard defensibility, and I've talked to a lot of PE and VC in this world, and I want to get your perspective on when you're looking at a business, because everybody has their different perspective, the way they look at it on a defensible model. And I think you maybe kind of, you know, shared a little bit in regards to like, okay, hey, what's the macro level? What's the trend looking like? Is this really solving a massive problem, right? A massive pain, difficulty, right? So that's very defensible, because guess what? When there's a massive demand for it, there's going to be natural. It's like just an evolution of a really successful growth business. But let me ask you, when you're looking at a defensible model, what other things are you looking for? Maybe are you looking at competitors in this market with this technology? Is it, you know, IP? Is there like, what other things are you looking at to make sure, hey, you know what this is? And then is that like on a scale exactly, like to mitigate your loss on the front end? Is that on a scale to say, hey, you know what, on a scale 1 to 10, 10 being the highest, you know, how defensible is this? Like, just help me understand the way you look
at it. Yeah, that's a great question. Depends a little bit on my company, right? And I would say this is the one where biggest difference here is really competitiveness. In a sense, you do need to have look at a lot of companies, but that particular type of companies are their actual play that they're going after. You have to have a look at a ton of them to really know whether or not this is on a 10 versus on a 1, because it's all relative, right? So when you think of, when it comes down to it, I'd say this. There's probably like two type of, you know, defensibility for deep tech, right? Branding isn't one of them. The one that's probably the strongest is business lock-in. For example, Picnic, right? Picnic's a pizza automation robotics company. They basically do pizza and sell it to Domino's the world. They bought Domino Germany, and they're basically pretty much the engagement with all the big pizza chain in the US. Domino's is probably not gonna like have like five different robotics vendors. They're probably gonna go with one, and they're just gonna deploy to everything else. So once you're in, what's the marginal benefit of getting another robot to replace Picnic? You know, it's not so much, right? Picnic's gonna be terrible. It's gonna be doing a terrible job, in which case it should be in the first place, in order to, you know, for Domino's to boot them out. So once for a lot of these guys, it's land expand, right? Once you do a pilot, and for robotics company, basically once you do pilots and hit certain critical milestone, basically you go from zero to a billion, you know, a million to a billion in overnight, literally. That's how Kiva does this as well. That's why Amazon, like 10 years ago at this point, acquired for 750 million, which is a big deal for robotics company at the time. But they literally go from zero to a billion overnight because they've sort of proven out. And that period of proven out requires this technological advantage. So when we look for companies where we think that the main defensibility is really going to come from the business lock-in, we just look for companies that are the best in class at what they do, that have a couple of years leg up. They're not going to have the leg up forever, right? This IP isn't going to hold indefinitely, but it should be long enough that it basically gives them the ability to go through this sales process, to do all the pilots, and able to get to this business lock-ins and to expansion. That's what you would really be looking for on the business side. Then you have another one where it's probably more of a really tech play, where you really, and this is much, much harder, you're looking for a 10x improvement in technology. So there's a company in our portfolio called Echo, which is a advanced ultrasound company. And Echo essentially is a unicorn at this point, turned unicorn a couple of months ago. But what they're able to do is to take ultrasound, typically cost 50K, 200K, get that down to be a portable size, but with efficacy that is far exceed the big advanced ultrasound. So you're talking about, you know, ability to cost down by 100 times. You talk about ability to make ultrasound even better than what's already in the market. Forget the part of ultrasound that far exceed anything that's already in the market. They're even more superior than the big clunky one. And that's just really breakthrough in the ability to do it. They're doing it in a way that, I don't want to go into technical babble as well, but essentially they're doing it in a way where no one else is able to do it. And these are, the founders are MEMS guys. They're semiconductor guys. They're not healthcare guys. And they're taking technology that's already proven in one field. They're applying it in the world of ultrasound. And they say, hey, can we make healthcare 10x better, but 100x more accessible? So that's the kind of, I would say there's two kind of defensibility. The second one is much, much harder to find. You usually find things that are, like 18 to 36 months ahead of everyone else. But you need that business lock-in to really make it work. Otherwise, you really, really have to go find something that's just 10x better, which is really, really hard.
Well, see, you're bringing up some really good stuff, and I really appreciate you talking a little bit about defensibility, because I was talking to someone that runs a fintech startup, and he was kind of showing me his model. And what I realized, it was just like a commodity. It was like just another service that any company could integrate into their kind of processing system on the fintech aspect. But what's interesting in what you're basically saying is that you want to make sure, because when you're selling the enterprise, you have to get them to also use the product. Otherwise, that product is not going to be used and you have a high churn rate later on, right? And so that's one of the things that I found so interesting is, like, speaking on what you basically said, is making sure that this product is not only solving a problem, but it's at such a massive pain that they want to use it and they want to integrate it into their business to solve what XYZ, because then the adaptation or adapting and integrating that product into your ecosystem, whatever that business is, it's very structural. And I appreciate, decommoditizing it, because that really just, allows you to, level up. And I appreciate you sharing that a little bit, understanding how you think about this. Now, let me ask you, because you did talk a little bit about obviously raising capital, getting them to that Series A, that story foundation, right? That founder story. How do you like to see the capital deployed? I know that's probably very contextual, but I would imagine, is there like some sort of like, okay, phase one, we want to be R&D, research development, make it to the product is, dialed in. Or do you like to push more toward, capital deployment in regards to, marketing and sales? Let's get this, let's launch this sucker and let's start making some sales. Or is it more operational and team structure and so forth? What does that look like? Or what are those stages, in that evolution?
Yeah. So I'll go on with these like two types of companies, right? One is probably more commercial ready. The other one is like medical device companies, right? It takes a bit longer on that road. So one of medical device companies obviously is pushing milestones. It's pushing milestones toward usually FDA approval or some kind of if it's battery company, some kind of performance threshold. That are universally known to be the gold standard. right? For battery, it could be like cycle time or charging time and stuff like that. Whereas for say AI companies, those would be more towards commercialization, right? You already have product, it already works, you know, as complicated it is. But now we want to see start that million, 2 million ARR to get to Series A. And it's engineering the path towards that. And that's also how our diligence is different, right? Because if it's a much more long time to commercialize kind of company, battery, medical devices and stuff, you really dive into the technical performance of the products. Is this, you know, is the technically one, is it really 10x in what the promise and compared to everything else? And two, can they actually get there? What is the path where are they now? Is it really feasible in the way they're getting there? So interestingly, we never put money into the bio company, right? We never put money into the cultural meat of the world, or you know, even plant-based meat, because we've looked at about 40, 50 companies, and the promise is fine. There's nothing wrong with the promise. We can never get behind the underlying technical assumption of how they're gonna scale the technology to be cost effective. And you're seeing it today. You're seeing beyond, you know, like even like plant-based struggling, right? The IPO of 2018, 19, something like that, it was boom, amazing. And now they're struggling because of the profitability factor. And I thought it was, well, the world was gonna hit the recession at some point. At that point, profitability can be kind of important. And it's not like you have to profitability today, but people are going to scrutinize it a lot more if there's no path to get there, especially as a later stage company, life's going to suck. So that's the kind of things we will look for as we look for, you know, highly deep tech company, is that are these underlying assumption for your technology, does it even make sense? Right, which means that you kind of need to have seen a ton of companies. Now, on the other side, for a more like a software AI oriented companies that are taking, you know, faster timeline to commercialization. In a way, it's easier. In a way, it's harder. It's easier from a technical standpoint. But then you really, really have to know the market. You have to know the market really well. You have to understand not just, you know, can you get a million ARR, but can you go beyond that? And usually that comes down to market structures and the sales and efficiency of the sales process as we relate to the market. Some market we just can't touch, like app, you want to, we've tried, we've seen, we've looked at it, but I don't know a way to sell to a million farmers. You know, just no efficient way to build a venture backable scale businesses selling to a million customers, you know, paying like $1,000, $5,000. It's just really, really hard. Not to say it doesn't work. It works sometimes, but the probability of making it work is so low.
You know, you really mentioned some really good stuff, and it's really good to hear and understand how you look at the markets at a macro, at a micro level, but also deal flow as well, and just how to really develop that defensible model. I was talking to one friend. I want to get your opinion on this. Sometimes when they acquire a company or like take a equity position in that company, you know, specifically VC, when they exit, they're thinking of the exit 4, 5, 7 years in advance. So a lot of times they actually have someone that is looking to acquire that person or that company that they've obviously taken a position in. So are you the same way in regards to like the,
oh,
the
yeah,
long-term vision of it? Okay, so you're like, hey, when I take
it. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, right. So I box, right? And you know, when you box, you know, you basically, before you pre-punches, you get out, right? So before you get in, you better know how to get out. Same way with BC, right? Except it's not 1, 2, 3 punches, like 7 year punches. So you're gonna go rolling punches for 7 years. You better know how to get out. So we do look at those dynamics. We do try to understand exactly who's gonna acquire these companies. We try to talk to these guys, see if something like this might be a roadmap. Obviously things change, if possible. And you know, we'll look at, you know, have these type of companies been exited? If so, by who? Maybe they've exhausted, you know, the entire acquire ecosystem. I mean, for a given industry, there isn't that many, right? Like how many med tech companies are going to be out there? So once we hone in on a target, and then we start having conversations with these guys to try to get in touch with them through bankers directly, through different conferences, try to get through the M&A team, the strategy team, Usually it's one or the other, you know, they're kind of synonymous, but for acquisition is one of these guys. You know, some of our friends, you know, went to school together, end up in one of these big M&A units anyway. So we talk to them a lot, and we try to understand what is it that you're gonna look for when you acquire them, right? And then usually don't tell you. It's rare that they tell you off the bat, oh yeah, we know exactly 1, 2, 3, 4. It's massaging, and it's getting them to think about, if you were to acquire this thing, one, how would it help your business? Why would it help your business? And if it were to really help your business, what parameters are needed to be true for these benefits to occur? And it's a two-way dialogue, and that's how you eventually get it to shape in their mind. Because obviously it's like 7 years out, and it doesn't go all down the far along the road. And then slowly you start to picture together what this will probably look like. And this is where it maps to, you know, from C to A, A to B, right? It should be from C to A, it should be going towards that final destination of the acquisition. You should be building towards that. You just put a milestone in between that investors are willing to fund to get there. But you should try to build towards that. It'll make no sense if you build from C to A to get those milestones, that's like 180 degree from where the ultimate decision needs to be. It's a kind of long detour. Yeah, it's been more successful in some than others. I got to be honest. You know, we want to get to all the, you know, key decision makers, important people for all these big corporates and stuff. And sometimes we kind of were surprised in certain cases. But yeah, that's something we actively try to do.
You know, when I was looking at, I was curious, when you're growing a company through that Series A, Series B, and obviously you're wanting to hit to 8, 9 figure, et cetera, and have a good, you know, successful, you know, solid seven year kind of exit at some point. When you guys are looking at a growth, do you guys focus on more of small, like in the SaaS world, we call them enterprise versus small biz, right? And so obviously we want to have, you know, a good kind of number of both, right? And every business is contextually different. I understand that, but I would ask you, you know, when you're looking at this kind of these industries and these companies, do you like to focus on kind of the big whales and their, you know, kind of their revenue base to really, you know, really, you know, jolt their revenue on the front end? Because you know that obviously you need less to make more, right? Which is fine, but the sales cycle, it takes a while sometimes. But you also talk in some of those smaller deals that may be easier to convert, but the churn rate is pretty high as well on the back end. But that's a pretty good sustainability, because obviously you're talking maybe, you know, 1,000, 3,000, 5,000, maybe 1,000,000, contracts or whatever it may be, you know, whatever you're selling, that is. So is that how you look at it as well? Or do you guys focus on kind of the mid-tier when you're structuring your kind of your offer? What does that look like?
Meaning like when we invest in a startup, do we prefer the startup that are tackling the whales, like the big enterprise versus, you know, SMB? Is that what you're saying? Or do I understand it?
Yes, that's my question. That's my question mainly, is because also when you're looking at the growth, do you focus majority of your time, because, you know, you guys want to scale pretty quickly within 7 years, do you mainly focus on the enterprise deals because you know that long term that'll produce a lot more cash flow? Or do you guys have like, you guys like to help them scale and focus both strategies or both avatars? Correct. SMBs or enterprise. So I was just curious what your thought process was on that.
Yeah. That's a great question. It comes down to risks. You know, the ultimately, what is traction? Traction is elimination of risk, right? And, you know, that's obviously, you know, probably like a fit risk. You know, can they sell it? But it's more than that too, right? Sometimes it's deployment. So, you know, if the two companies, right, exact same companies, two robotics company. They both have, you know, great tractions. If there's some enterprise, one have deployed 10 robots, the other have deployed no robots. The deployment risk is significant because you do not know if the robot actually works. So, you know, even if it's a picnic close Domino's, and there's another guy who closed, I don't know, Pizza Hut, right? But if Picnic have deployed 10, you know, just 10 robots, and we can see how it works, and we can talk to the customers how the scalability of it is actually going to be, we have much higher certainty that if you put, you know, especially for later stage companies, for later stage funds, they have much higher certainty that if they picnic 50 million, they could have gone rocket. Versus if they give this guys, even with, you know, more contracts or whatnot, you just don't know where they can actually deploy and scale and how quickly that's going to be, right? So it's a combination of that. So as you mentioned, you know, big epic enterprise just have more complexity, long sales cycles, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a gauge. Obviously, you know, in most cases, yes, we prefer the companies that have the enterprise contract cap. But depending on the kind of technologies and the companies and all of that, sometimes we do need to see, we do want a company to de-risk deployment. We do want to see the products working in the customer hands and not being broken, and you know, all the support, customer success systems is up and running. So it's nuanced in that sense. Versus, say, battery company, we almost don't care. Like if you get BMW, you get BMW and that's pretty much it, right? You, basically, if your battery make into the next generation of all BMW series 3, 5, and 7, you're done for, right? It doesn't matter at that point. And you're still manufacturing some other time. So there's that nuance in terms of, well, it depends on the kind of companies. We have companies that are selling to SMB, right? They started off selling, it's a very interesting company called Ford Robotics. And this is the only company in our portfolio that pivoted successfully before they meet us anyway. They were building mining robots. And for mining robots, it was imperative that when the robot spot, you know, the mine, you can stop the robot. And they couldn't find something for mobile robots that can stop the robot consistently, you know, with the least amount of lag, because lag is super important. Wait a second, when the robot spot the mine, boom, bam, right, oh, it's gone. So they built their own, essentially is a remote control robotics for essentially, you know, for wireless control and selfish and everything. And, you know, people start asking, hey, what do you use? Like, do you build your own? Hey, can you kind of like sell some like to us and some of his friends? Like, sure. And then over time, words just get out. And this company basically realized that the sales from selling the remote control exceed the sales of robots. And so they found that they actually have a real business because they were seed companies selling mining robots for 7 years. And when they come and raise from us, they were like, yeah, we're a mining company, but you know, we have like this product everyone wants. And so we want to go and commercialize it. So we're like, okay, sure, you know, we gave them some money. And they just exploded. And we actually only realized that it is so well, because we keep seeing their remote control on other robotics company pitch deck. We're just like, hey, they're all using Ford remote control. And we just basically like, hey, you know, guys, like, how are you guys doing? Oh yeah, our sales like, you know, 4X this year. And they were just selling to all the startups. Well, a lot of these guys from the startup got picked up by the enterprise people. And the enterprise people were like, well, I mean, what's the standard for the industry for remote control? It's like, oh, well, this, you know, this company called Ford. Okay, we'll just use it. So there is that hat from a startup. They just become a standard because everyone's using it. And this is basically break into enterprise. And now they're doing super, super well. They're doing 15 million this year because of that hat. And I would say this is a bit of a convoluted path. I would not imagine this to be a playbook. We wouldn't pick a company for this playbook, right? It's sort of a bizarre playbook. And this is where, you know, Sam, the founder, is really amazing. He's really, really great at what he does. Founder's ability does matter. But it's, you know, it's much more rare for deep tech. It does happen. And the ability to maneuver, you know, around is super important, because as you get to enterprise contracts, you do need the ability to maneuver and through all the hoops, to get all the buy-in and all of these things. It does exist to sign enterprise contract. But yeah, occasionally it does manifest when you sell to SMB first and eventually to enterprise contracts. That does happen. It also happens a lot in AI company that does require data. You're not gonna get a bunch of data from a large enterprise. You're more likely to get the data from a small amount of pop, and you build the data and you build, you know, the accuracy and everything up to 95-97%, whatever it is. And then you start going off the enterprise. So occasionally it works. It's not, our go-to playbook, but it does happen from time to time.
Dude, I love that story, man. And that is hilarious what you had to go through a little bit. But it's also interesting, and I love that perspective because, like you mentioned, it's not a consistent methodology, but it does work every now and then. And like you mentioned, so I appreciate you being on, man. I just love just your story, your journey. You obviously have an incredible portfolio a little bit, as well as just, you know, really hitting humanity's crisis, right? That's kind of your investment thesis and unpacking your strategy, the way you look at things, different from being years of experience and obviously have an incredible, you know, portfolio underneath Creative Ventures. For those that are listening to this podcast that want to maybe be part of what you got going on, want to learn a little bit more as well, how do they reach out to you and be part of what you got going on, champ?
Yeah, you know, obviously you can reach out to me at champ, C-H-A-M-P, champ at Creative Ventures, with an S.VC. So if you have questions, you want to chat, you want to share your ideas of what you're doing, if you're an LP, if you can invest, we'll probably open up a fund for you early next year. Happy to have a conversation.
Awesome, my guys. Those links are in the description below, so make sure you stop what you're doing. I put his LinkedIn account as well as his website, creativeventures.vc. So make sure you stop what you're doing and be part of what he's got going on. He's got some really cool stuff going. And champ, again, I really appreciate you just being on here, man. I just was taking so many notes. I just love to even talk about the defensible model and the way you look at it and the structure and mitigating the loss, because there's so much due diligence that you have to ensure that obviously the individuals that, I mean, the deals that you invest in, your time, energy, and effort, you know, the likeliness of a profitability on the back end is much, much more likely. And champ, I always love to ask my guests before I let you go fully, is there any last words of wisdom they'd like to share with our audience?
Yeah, great question. Do the hardest thing first, because everything else would just become easier, right? A lot of people, a lot of people make mistakes too. When you're racing the funds and everything, you can't talk to, like, you know, people who are safer first. But, you know, whatever you do, I mean, obviously don't burn all the bridges, but begin with the hardest people to convince, because everyone else becomes so much easier and then you learn so much more, right? I'd say I'll part with that.
Well said, man. Well said. Guys, that is the general partner at Creative Ventures, my friend, champ, Suthipongchai. Guys, that is Journey with Christian Davis podcast. Until next time, be uncommon if you can. Yo, this is Christian D. Evans, Journey with Christian D. Evans podcast. We thank you so much for listening to this amazing episode. If you feel and you know that this was valuable to you, please show some love to our amazing guest by liking this, by commenting on this, by making sure that you do a nice 5-star review, and just show some love to our guest. That'd be really awesome. Also, make sure you share this with a friend, a family, a colleague, someone that you believe would bring value to their life right now. And guys, we just want to say thank you again for just being part of our community. If you want to have more resources, don't be afraid. Go to christiandevans.com. You can actually schedule a phone call with me, or you can send me an email at christian.evans@beuncommonifyoucan.com. That's christian.evans@beuncommonifyoucan.com. Always love to hear some feedback and let me know what is the number one or two things that you are struggling in your business and your life, and we'll make sure we have those conversations. Guys, that is Journey with Christian Davis podcast. And until next time, remember, be uncommon if you can. Cheers.